I crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came, and when he saw him, he fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands upon her so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him, and a large crowd followed and pressed in on him on every side. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better. In fact, she grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his clothes. For she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned around in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say who touched me?" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came to him in fear and trembling, fell down before him and told him the truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion? The child is not dead, but is sleeping." And they laughed at him. And he put them all outside, and he took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha, whom?" Which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. And they were overcome with amazement. And he strictly ordered them that no one should know this. And he told them to give her something to eat. May the Lord add his blessing to this reading of his holy word. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, for God truly is our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
I wish I could go out to the market and buy fresh fruit and vegetables.
that I'm only allowed out of this tent that my parents have created for me for an hour each day. I would not be able to make it to the market and back in that amount of time. And I've been like this for 12 years. I can remember back to a time when I would go to the market with my mother each day. My mother and I would get up, cook some breakfast for my father and my brothers, and then we'd leave the house. We would enjoy the weather and the walk and the company and business of the marketplace. I never knew how much you could miss people. Even people yelling at each other over the price of herbs and spices. I'm desperate to hear other people's voices. Now my mother brings food to me each morning and places it 20 feet away from where I sleep, just as the holiness code demands. And she waits for me to get it. She stands far away from me, which I can tell hurts her as much as it hurts me. I wish I could hug her sometimes. But I know that if I did, she would be unclean and forced to go to the priest and spend time outside of her house until she is ritually purified. It is so isolating to live in silence most of the time. The silence is deafening and painful, and I'm desperate for freedom from this loneliness. When I don't eat for a few days, obviously I get very weak and I can't move around. In the past, there have been many days when I have just curled up in a ball, lying on my mat and crying. But I have a good friend. I have a friend named Mary who comes and visits me regularly. Mary is a woman who takes risks. She doesn't seem to care about the holiness laws or about how I am considered unclean. At first, she only came once a month when she was considered unclean, too. But now she comes more often when she's passing by. Mary is following the new rabbi. In the past year, she's been stopping by whenever she can. Since we live on the outskirts of town, she can get away with it, and no one finds out that she comes and visits me in my empty tent. Mary is a great encouragement to me. She is the only friend who is still willing to talk with me like I am a normal person. We used to have a great circle of friends when we were growing up, and we did all the things normal girls do. But Mary can relate with me because she's not married either. I could never marry because of my continual uncleanness. I don't understand exactly why they call it being unclean. They just want to consider me dirty. That's what they want to say. But I don't feel dirty. I was always told that I had sins in my life and that I must have done something really evil to deserve it. But I don't think that's right. I always went to temple and I followed the law and I obeyed my parents. I was even ready to marry whomever they wanted me to marry. But after the first few months of my bleeding, I began to worry. I knew that something wasn't right. Ever since those days, I have been banished from my community. Mary keeps telling me that she thinks I will get better. She just has a feeling. Oh, if only that was true. I'm so desperate. Desperate for freedom from the pain outside and inside. A few days ago, Mary, came and told me that the new rabbi would be close to where I live for a couple of days. She said she didn't know exactly when they would arrive, but they always seemed to congregate around the Sea of Galilee. So that I should at least try to come and see him, this spiritual leader called Jesus. She told me that he had been known to heal people, and that if I asked, maybe he could heal me. And she told me that my chin started to tremble and my eyes swelled up with tears. Heal me? Me? A woman who no one will talk to, touch, or even look at? There was a nice breeze this morning when I set out. Maybe there is always a nice breeze, but it's been so long since I was able to feel the fresh air on my skin and the air catching my hair and whipping it around. I smell the sea. I saw the sights that I hadn't seen since I was a child. I was among the first people to arrive here on the seashore today. It was so beautiful to see the waves rolling in against the sand and hear the children running around and playing. Those were things I haven't experienced in a long time. I sat down by myself, tucked away out of sight, when all of a sudden everybody got up and started rushing toward the beach. From where I was, I couldn't see what was happening, but then I saw the boat. And I spotted Mary in the crowd, making her way down to the shore too. All of a sudden I got butterflies. I was really nervous. I wanted to go and talk to Jesus. I wanted to ask him to heal me. From what Mary told me, he was able to do this. I was desperate to believe that. Then I saw him getting out of the boat, and the crowd pushed in all around him. His clothes were getting wet, and I could tell he just wanted to climb out of the water and onto the sand. But so many people were clamoring for his attention. I hoped that I would be able to at least talk to him. But he is a holy man, I know. And the last thing that I can do, or should do, is reach out to a holy man. I would make him unclean. He stopped. Oh no, there's Jairus, one of the rulers of the synagogue in my town. He knows me. He knows I'm unclean. Please, God, do not let him see me and find me out. Please don't let him take away this little bit of hope that I have left. Jairus looks determined, and he looks upset. Suddenly, he stopped. He stopped at the feet of Jesus and threw himself down. I don't know what's going on, but now Jesus is leaving with him. I must get to Jesus before he's gone. I don't know what to do, but I have to get there. I struggled down to the sand to get closer. I'll never forget the feeling of that sand between my toes and salt stinging my eyes as I desperately moved through the crowd. Even though my clothes brushed up against people, I went anyway. And luckily, no one was paying attention to me. They were all concerned about Jesus and why he was leaving with Jairus. I pressed forward, and finally, when Jesus was within a few yards of me, just a little more, and I reached out and was able to grab the hem of his robe. In that moment, something happened to me. The pain that I had felt for 12 years suddenly disappeared. And I knew in an instant that my suffering was over. He had healed me.
me.
He made me whole again.
I realized I was shaking.
All of a sudden, Jesus stopped and turned around.
Who touched me?
He said.
Who touched him?
Everyone was touching him, but he looked right at me. I knew that he knew. And he knew that I knew. He knew I was desperate. It was hard for me to look up at him. He did not appear to be angry, but he did appear concerned. He knew that I was healed. He was smiling. My mind was racing. What do I say? How do I explain myself? I had seen Jairus fall at his feet, and this seemed to work for him, so I did the same. I fell down and wept. I must have been incoherent as I blurted out my story, and I told him how I was desperate for freedom from this prison of uncleanness and isolation. I wanted the freedom he offered, and I had hoped that he would be able to make me better. I told him how I had felt his power come into my body and make me well. With tears streaming down my face, I finally looked up into his eyes. His eyes pierced me, and I'm convinced he saw into the depths of my soul. He saw my desperation, my pain, my loneliness, my hurt. But he saw more. Beyond that, he saw me as a person and as someone he valued and cared about. Jesus loved me. And he gave me back my place in my community. He gave me hope for the rest of my life. I will never forget the beautiful words he spoke. Daughter, he called me, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. And now I come here to tell you my story of my desperation and my freedom from my prison. Through the healing touch that's changed me and my heart and my body and my life. I know that you too are desperate for freedom, for belonging, for healing, for many things, even for hope. What is it that you are desperate for? What kind of healing do you need? Because Jesus is here. And you only have to talk.